bless, O Lord, us thy servants who minister in thy temple, and grant that what we sing with our lips we may believe in our hearts, and what we believe in our hearts we may show forth in our lives, through the same Christ our Lord.
O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Let the whole earth stand in awe of him. Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done. And we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises, declared unto mankind, in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, and hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all them that truly repent and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore, let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord, open thou our lips.
And our mouths shall show forth thy praise.
O God, make spare to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Praise ye the Lord.
A very warm welcome tonight to our service of choral evensong for the feast of Christ the King, when we rejoice to celebrate Jesus' just and gentle reign upon us. A very warm welcome especially tonight to our preacher, the Reverend Imogen Ney, and to the youth consort of St. George's Cathedral, Southwark. And welcome back to their director of music, Jonathan Schrantz, who is an undergraduate and member of our choir here, from 2012 to 2015. It's a joy to have such a mass of passionate and gifted singers join our ranks this evening. Our psalm tonight is number 148, which we stand to sing antiphonally with the choir, and the words and chant can be found in your notice sheet.
Praise him, all his soul.
Our first lesson is taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 1. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome, and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome. And it was so. God called the dome sky, and there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees of every kind on earth that bear fruit with the seed in it." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed of every kind, and trees of every kind bearing fruit with the seed in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night. And let there be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth." And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the stars, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, "Let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the dome of the sky." So God created the great sea monsters, and every living creature that moves of every kind, with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters in the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things, and wild animals of the earth of every kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every kind, and everything that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God he created them. Male and female he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." God said, "See, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And it was so. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Here ends the lesson.
We stand to sing our first hymn, the words of which can be found on your separate hymn sheet, "Christ Triumphant, Ever Reigning."
Thank you.
The second reading is taken from the book of Revelation, chapter 11, starting at verse 15. Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven, saying, "The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Messiah, and he will reign forever and ever." Then the 24 elders who sit on their thrones before God fell on their faces and worshipped God, singing, "We give you thanks, Lord God Almighty, who are and who were, for you have taken your great power and begun to reign. The nations raged, but your wrath has come, and the time for judging the dead, for rewarding your servants, the prophets and saints, and all who fear your name, both small and great, and for destroying those who destroy the earth." Here ends the second reading.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Good counsel.
proceed. Give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee, we being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness through the merits of Jesus Christ our Saviour.
It's wonderful tonight to welcome as our preacher the Reverend Imogen Ney, newly appointed Vicar of St Paul's Hills Road. Imogen studied in Cambridge and is excited to be back, returning after a rich ministry in the Midlands and South London to continue to live out her commitment to the fundamental role of the church in the local community and to carry on her research into contemporary nature writing and Christian understandings of creation, which makes her a very appropriate preacher for our sixth day in our In the Beginning sermon series. And before we listen to Imogen's words tonight, we continue in our prayer and reflection as the choir sings tonight's anthem, which is a setting of verses from Psalm 96 by the contemporary Scottish composer James Macmillan, A New Song.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the invitation to be here with you this evening, especially to reflect with you on the theme of creation and the environment. May I speak in the name of God, who is creator, redeemer, and sustainer. And so we gather together today at the end of the liturgical year on the feast of Christ the King. And we move from creation to the end times in our readings and are asked to consider how Christ holds all things together. Such a task can perhaps make us feel a little dizzy, and the words of apocalyptic literature, of which the book of Revelation is an example, can challenge us with its imagery. Yet what apocalyptic literature seeks to do is to view the whole of creation at its point of final redemption. The place at which the true glory of God is revealed, and the various and diverse deceptions and lies which corrupt and betray the experience of all living things are revealed for what they truly are, falsehoods. And as such, it is a hopeful vision, for it is one in which and through which we are promised that truth and reality are co-existent, a promise we need to hold on to in our current world. To connect the account of creation in Genesis with the final book of the Bible is to move through thousands of years and then through millennia. It is to both see the naive account of creation for what it is, naive, whilst recognizing that it contains the truth of our Creator's intention to make, pronounce good, and bless. Whatever our experiences of being alive, whether they be good, awful, wonderful, terrible, beautiful, challenging, awe-inspiring, painful, mundane, and perhaps all of these, we place them within the framework of not only creation as blessing, but creator as redeemer. And this is what I think connects Genesis with Revelation and the feast of Christ the King. God creates, and in Christ, God redeems. But how does God create and redeem both at the same time? I think it is through the incarnation, the enfleshing of God, in which God brings about a new creation. We heard about singing a new song just now. In the incarnation, truly our salvation is almost and completely achieved. The incarnation is a surprising, miraculous, mysterious wonder in which creation and new creation, birth and salvation, are intimately intertwined. How does this happen? Well, St. Paul writes that Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible. What a wonder and mystery is that. In Christ, creation, the cosmos, the universe, the universes are held together. He is activator, still point, and finisher. St. Paul continues, he himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. The uncreated word, Jesus Christ, the second person of the Trinity, is both creation and death, or at least he experiences being created and dying, and in so doing combines and unites the temporal with the eternal. And for an age discovering the importance of the interconnectedness of all things, such an interpretation of what and who Christ is and how he exists is remarkably prescient. Moreover, it stretches our human-centered salvation history in ways that it's desperate to be stretched. To limit the idea of salvation to humans is to limit God's saving action in Christ. Moreover, human salvation makes no sense apart from the restoration of the whole of creation, if it really is true that Christ is in all and that through him all things hold together. Perhaps we should think about it this way. In our Genesis reading, we see the creation of the universe, and we see that humans are given a special place in the creation narrative. Yet at no point is their or our material existence distinct from the existence of everything else that has been made. We are related in an interconnected, mutually dependent way with the whole of creation, with all matter. To transpose human salvation onto an elsewhere that is disconnected from the rest of creation is to misunderstand the nature of the universe and God's saving action in Christ. Humans may have a particular responsibility due to their agency, power, and moral sense, but we are not substantially different from the air we breathe or the water that we drink. And we've realized afresh, haven't we, in the past 50 years or so, with increasing ferocity, as we've noticed that our seas are filthy repositories of human waste, that our local rivers are not fit to swim or baptize in, that the corrupted air we breathe is killing our children, and that plastic, rather than God, is omnipresent, haunting us with its longevity and enticing us with its practicality. So when we've talked over and over again in Protestant history about personal salvation, we have, I suggest, distorted the gospel by suggesting that individuals can be saved apart from the whole of creation. I believe in God, alternatively, it could be argued, not to secure a place in heaven, but so that the birds in my garden and the soil I walk upon might be released to praise God. I believe because I desire the restoration of all things. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in the hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. The children of God, those who believe and love, and do so on behalf of the whole of creation, not just for themselves. As our Saviour has taught us in his self-giving act of love, we believe not for our own benefit, but so that all might live. And Richard Balcombe, former Cambridge New Testament scholar, writes that the incarnation proves transformative for the whole creation, because the loving self-identification of the crucified Christ with the whole creation in its tragedy its disharmony and decay, as well as the glory of its profusion and vitality, draws the whole creation with him into the eschatological novelty of his resurrection. He himself is the goal of creation, in that it will be in relation to him that the whole creation comes to fulfillment. The cosmic Christ, then, is indeed the Christ who is in all and for all, remarkably consistent, perhaps surprisingly, with contemporary ideas of ecology and a focus on holistic health and well-being. We live not alone and for ourselves, but with each other in relation to all that has been made. The sooner we grasp this truth fully, the sooner we may reform our practices and be part of the good news for the whole of creation. And so then, as we hold together God the Creator with the idea of the cosmic Christ, we are challenged to enable all living things, all that has been made, to be set free to glorify God. So let's end with a passage from Dostoevsky's Brothers Karamazov. He writes, "Love all God's creation, the whole and every grain of sand in it. Love every leaf, every ray of God's light. Love the animals, love the plants, love everything. If you love everything, you will perceive the divine mystery in all things. Once you perceive it, you will begin to comprehend it better every day. And you will come at last to love the whole world with an all-embracing love." Amen.
Let us pray. The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord. We pray that God may give us vision and stretch our minds to know and love and care for our deeply interconnected world, held together and restored in Christ. Eternal Father, whose Son, Jesus Christ, ascended to the throne of heaven that he might rule over all things as Lord and King, keep the Church in the unity of the Spirit and in the bond of peace, and bring the whole created order to worship at his feet, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. He hath put down the mighty from their seat, and hath exalted the humble and meek. We pray for all those who rule and hold power. May mercy and meekness be true might in the image of our Saviour Christ, and all dominion held through the law of love. Eternal God, fount and source of all authority and wisdom, hear our prayer for those who govern. Give to Charles, our King, grace as the symbol of loyalty and unity for our different peoples. Give to the parliaments in these islands wisdom and skill, imagination and energy. And give to the members of the European institutions and all nations throughout the world, vision, understanding, and integrity, that all may live in peace and happiness, truth and prosperity, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray for the congregations and leaders of the churches of St. Paul's Hills Road and St. George's Cathedral, Southwark. And we ask that the people who worship in those places may be built up ever more and more into the shape of God's kingdom on heaven and in earth. Eternal God, in whose perfect realm no sword is drawn but the sword of righteousness, and no strength known but the strength of love, so guide and inspire the work of those who seek your kingdom, that all your people may find their security in that love which casts out fear, and in the fellowship revealed to us in Jesus Christ our Saviour. Amen. We pray for our colleges of Selwyn and of Newnham, for the communities made up of staff, fellows and students. We pray for all those who are anxious and suffering within our communities, amongst those who make their spiritual home here and otherwise known to us. O Lord, the resurrection and the life of them that believe, who didst enrich thy servant, George Augustus Selwyn, with thy manifold gifts of grace, grant that all who serve thee here may be taught by his example to serve in their several callings to the honour of thy name, who livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. We stand to sing our second hymn, Christ Triumphant, Ever Reigning.
Thank you.